functional electrical stimulation in the rehabilitation of upper extremity after stroke. And the reason for choosing upper extremity rehabilitation is because it accounts for a majority of functions, a lot of functions that we even consider as lower extremity functions, but still I would say that upper extremity is a part of those functions, as simple as walking, that you don't walk without a reason. And the reason is taken care by many times the upper extremity. And with any injury, pathology, or impairment, upper extremity leads to a huge amount of social burden. What we have seen after stroke is that only about 20% of the patients recover the function of upper extremity. And this is despite rehabilitation that not more than 30 to 60% patients are functional after stroke, despite the best efforts of rehabilitation. So there is a huge need for efforts towards recovery of upper extremity. Now, a lot of times that I don't know what comes first, is it the chicken or the egg, but is it because the recovery is, the prognosis is not expected, the outcomes are not expected to be good, that the effort towards upper extremity is not much? Or is it that the upper extremity doesn't recover much, that we don't put in much effort, or much effort is not given to that? So a lot of times we are dependent on what happens spontaneously. The amount of recovery that happens automatically even without rehabilitation. And many times what we see is that we never reach the levels that was before the injury. That is, the patients don't recover their level of functioning, their level of activities that they used to do prior to the stroke. And this is just because, this is just because the recovery is not a smooth process, and there are many obstacles in the way, from a totally weak and flaccid limb to a totally functional limb. There are many obstacles in the way, and the recovery is never complete. And you cannot be sure that the recovery is always to the fully functional level. So it can stop at any way in between. The recovery a lot of times is slow. It stops, and there are stages. And I don't know, we choose it or we don't choose it. A lot of times it stops at the point that they are the most disabled. That is the stage where they show the most severe pain, most severe spasticity, most severe of their edema or swelling in the hand. Many patients don't allow even to touch their hand. And somehow you feel that the recovery has stopped at that level. And something has to be done. But a lot of times, I don't know, even today, many people think of stroke as a weakness of muscles. And a lot of treatment still goes to the periphery. Whereas we must understand that because of lack of use of the extremity, or because of weakness, there are a lot of changes that are happening in the nervous system as well. That leads to a cycle of more and more restricted use of the affected upper extremities. So the initial pathology or the primary injury is in the nervous system, leads to a secondary loss of function in the extremities, which again leads to a loss of representation in the CNS, leading to further reduced use of the upper extremity. So what a lot of times we are targeting is the secondary problem. Secondary problem is the weakness. And most of the treatments are targeting the periphery, whereas the target should be the central nervous system. And because of the wrong objective or the wrong outcomes that are selected for rehabilitation, sometimes we do not actually calculate the end point of a rehabilitation. Sometimes we fail to estimate the cost of rehabilitation and how prolonged it should be. It is easy to say that rehabilitation takes months. It is very easy to say it is a slow process, but you have to be in it. But I would say that rehabilitation can be faster than what we are doing, probably we are missing where we should be targeting. And there are a lot of thought processes about how much recovery and whether it is possible. But yes, recovery is possible, and we should not be dependent on spontaneous or automatic recovery happening in the nervous system, but also targeting the experience-dependent neuroplasticity. That is the capability of the brain to reorganize based on the experiences. And just I would like to go to the previous slide, where if the experiences are not good, that is how the brain reorganizes itself. And with time, the limbs become non-functional. So we need to create opportunities where the experiences provided to the patient are good, at a right time, in a right way, and in right amounts. The problem in certain rehabilitation scenarios are that we treat the patient based on the available resources, and that is not wrong. We have to be practical in our management. We cannot have all the technologies in the world. We cannot work according to best evidences anywhere in the world, but at least the rehabilitation should use what might work or what is effective. We all should strive for a better rehabilitation. So the need is to provide meaningful, repetitive, a more intensive rehabilitation, which also provides a feedback. And one such technology that is not something new is electrical stimulation, where you are using electrical currents to stimulate peripheral muscles. And we are trying to replace the signals that the brain or the nervous system sends to activate the muscles by a stimulator. Whereas if we recognize or if we look deeply, there is a lot of difference in a signal sent by the brain in the way that before it sends a signal, there is a lot of planning that goes in. Whereas if you look at an artificial stimulation of a muscle by electrical stimulation, that planning or going of the feedback does not matter to the equipment or the machine. So actually we are artificially stimulating, but not replacing what the nervous system or what the brain has to do. And the rehabilitation becomes preserving or maintaining the function rather than improving the function or repairing or recovering the brain. So from maintaining and preserving, we have to go to improvement. And we know that the neuromuscular stimulation is not popular for its efficacy because there is not much of problem solving involved with a normal electrical stimulation rehabilitation. And the movements that are produced with the help of stimulator are not always skillful and goal-directed. So in textbooks and articles, I have read that rehabilitation has been accused of either being too late or too little. And we have seen that both are not good for the better outcomes. So there is a need for rehabilitation technology to bridge that gap of intensity of rehabilitation. We need to give more repetitions. We need to be more intense in training. So in a situation where a one-to-one therapy may not be the most resource efficient, may not be the most cost effective, here the technology comes into picture. And many times that there are resources, but the decisions we take are not the right. So there is a need that with the available resources, the decision have to be much, much better. And one such technology or advancement of the normal electrical stimulation or the neuromuscular electrical stimulation is the functional electrical stimulation. But many of you would still question that it is still artificial stimulation of the muscle. But the change here is that this stimulation is done during the practice of functional tasks. And we are not only stimulating, but trying to coordinate the efforts of the patient with the stimulation of the machine. So functional stimulation is used in a functional context where the effort of the patient is coordinated with the technology that assists the movement and provides more selectivity to the muscles that are involved in function. Now, these things have been used as a permanent solution to losses that are irreparable, or where the recovery does not progress, or we are sure that the deficits are permanent. So we give functional electrical stimulation as an implanted permanent device, and it becomes the orthotic effect. And where we are using it for training as a transcranial device, that is the therapeutic effect of functional stimulation. Now, electrical stimulation has long been used for mobility or movement, to recreate a movement in the joints. But I would say that functional stimulation has advanced to provide stability and stability with mobility. So both the functions and both the outcomes can be achieved through electrical stimulation. What we need to understand today is, as my previous speakers were talking about, that the lack of awareness and lack of knowledge about technology is the biggest barrier that a technology is not used. Now, we have to be sure that electrical stimulation in this way is not just provided for muscle strengthening, but we need to bring about a change in the nervous system. And we must understand that though it appears that it is activating the muscles, but the effects are more than just motor effects or the muscular effects. What it has shown is that the perfusion in the nervous system and the activation of the primary and the primary motor and the sensory cortices improve by just peripheral stimulation, not just because of the electrical currents, but because of the effects that it produces by stimulating the muscles, by the movement of the joint, which also sends a signal to the brain. So the conclusion is that an associative intervention where the brain effort or the cognitive effort are synchronized with the peripheral stimulation would be much more effective than just neuromuscular stimulation. The question comes, and who triggers the peripheral stimulation, because it is still not the brain. But then there have been advances, and the brain-controlled or EEG-controlled stimulators are now being used, although not much in India, but they are still being used. And there are also systems that are utilizing EMG biofeedback-based muscle stimulation. And not only that, but there is also a combination of treatments like use of mirror therapy, mental therapy, and brain stimulation. So it is not just a peripheral bottom-up approach of treatment, but also a top-down approach where you are working on the primary impairments of the CNS to change the peripheral receptors and the muscle actions. Thank you.